Well, hello, hello. It is Thursday, and we are getting ready for our live show. We usually start at 8 p.m. Pacific Standard, but I wanted to start a little bit early today. Let me just make sure I put this on silent so no calls come through. And as we let the audience begin to arrive, we just want to make sure our hair looks good. Here is my lovely wife.
Hello.
Speaking of hair looking good.
What about my hair?
You have some stragglers out there.
You can't see it.
I can see it. I have an eye. Keen eye.
Hello, brother Jorge. We saw your pictures today at, I believe you were hiking. Beautiful pictures.
So we're just gonna wait a few moments while people start to join. Hi, Veronica. Thanks for joining us. We're just getting ready. We'll start in a few minutes now. Hi there, Melody. Hope all is well. We're getting ready to start our show in a few moments now. We wanted to start kind of just by seeing how Lent has gone for you. For our Lent, I mean, for me, it's been a good Lenten season. Busy. Lent is always a very busy time. A lot going on, a lot of challenges, but also a lot of growth, spiritual growth. So that's been good. Hopefully the same for you. If Lent has been good for you this year, go ahead and give us a thumbs up so we can know that Lent is going great. Joanna.
Yes.
How was your Lent?
Hi, Melody. Well, my Lent has been pretty wild.
Action-packed.
Pepe. Hola, Salud. Pepe. He's drinking coffee today, and I'll be eating dessert later. I'll tell you guys what this is. So this Lent, I decided to work on my personal relationship with God and just have that more, that one-on-one time with Him since the beginning of my day. I usually do it, but it was very short. Hey, hi, Ricky. I was going to say, hey, Ricky.
Hello, Father. Cheers.
This is my father.
Glad you're joining us today. Sorry.
Continue. And so yeah, that's what my Lent was all about. I was very into it, for 2 weeks, straight. Why? One, because we didn't have anything. We kind of had, it was just pretty free, you know, the beginning of Lent. And then
it's always easier when you first start.
Right.
And then you kind of get.
Yeah. And then life happens. Disappointment happens.
Right.
No, I'm just kidding.
Speaking of disappointment. No, but I think just like New Year's resolutions, right? Like everybody makes those plans and those goals. And,
or losing
and
weight.
The first week or so goes great and then it kind of starts to go downhill from there. So is that how it went for you?
Yes, definitely. That's how I think it is. And it's a normal thing. And I think that's what being a human is all about, you know, and understanding and learning and knowing that
failure?
No. Oh my God.
No, because we're going to talk a little bit about that failure. And
your commitment, like it's still there, right, and you know it kind of, you're going. I think it's harder for women. Hello,
hi, Janice.
You know, especially for a mom like me, it's not easy. You know, having two boys, very close age. And doing everything that we do, it's you have to juggle a lot, you know. So I think that's what happens. And this past 2 weeks, and we're gonna share that later, you know, in this video of disappointment, you know.
Yeah.
Things just, you know, we're super super busy, definitely draining, like spiritually, emotionally, mm-hmm. And we're gonna, you know,
which is also good in a way.
Yeah, it is good, but even though I didn't work on what I thought I had in mind, you know, of Lent, I learned a lot through those 2 weeks, you know.
Good point.
So, you know, I started with something in mind that I was going to do, and I did, but then
so
the end result
evolved.
Right, the end well, result, you know, was very different. So but you know, I think it was good. Like I said, we'll talk about it, you know. It's not that I was disappointed, but things just happen, you know.
Surprised.
To be different.
You were surprised by the outcome.
So that was my Lent. How about yours?
Mine was good. I think my big thing this Lent was focusing on daily prayer, making sure to, like, just like Joanna said, making time with God every morning. And I actually did that. So The way I did it was I kind of made a commitment. I'm going to pray the rosary every morning. I wake up usually around 5 o'clock on a good day. And because I got to do it before everybody else wakes up, or it gets really hard. Cheers. After that. So I did that, and almost every single day. I'm sure I missed a few days here and there. But I did that, and I also doing those Lenten reflection videos. So every day I've been putting out a reflection, written reflection, and then doing a video version of that as well. And that was, it's kind of time consuming. It's definitely a commitment. There was days where I woke up and I'm like, I really don't want to record this video right now. But it's like Joanna said, you make that commitment. And so, you know, for me personally, I have no problem saying, okay, you know what, I'm done with this. But having made that commitment to other people and knowing that those videos are helping other people in their during their Lenten challenges, you know, I didn't want to give up on that. So I stuck through it. I'm actually going to continue until Sunday. So I have 3 more to do. In a way, I'm glad for it to be over, just to have a break. But I'm glad. It's challenging in many ways. And it kind of ties back into the whole theme of disappointment, which is what we're going to talk about tonight. And so that's kind of, I guess, how my Lent has gone. It's been challenging. I lost my job during the Lenten season. So it's full of challenges, but also full of blessings and full of grace. Just being able to watch how God has worked in our lives, I think, mm-hmm. is always a big part of what Lent is all about. So
that's have you cool. thought about if last time you got laid off, it was the same time?
It was,
right? Because we got married in August.
February. I think it was in February.
So it wasn't around the same time. I was going to say, okay, that's kind of freaky.
Yeah, twice from the same company during the same time of year. Yeah, that'd be funny.
It was kind of around that time. Anyways, we're eating. Well, I'm eating. I made some tres leches.
She didn't share it with me.
Oh, you want one? I can bring you one. Ricky's drinking coffee.
Cafecito.
I got this really awesome deal at the dollar store. What brand is it?
Maxwell House.
Maxwell House. What is it called? QK.
Keurig cups. Hi, Maria.
Hi, Maria. 12 for a dollar. So I got him 3 boxes, and he's like, oh, you really do love me. I'm like, yes, I do.
Because she doesn't even drink coffee, so it's
not like coffee. I think it makes me sick, but I figured out it's the milk.
It's the creamer.
Yes, buddy.
So we're about to get started. Hello, Father. We're funny. Oh, well, thank you. Thank you for the kind words. Hopefully we're entertaining and not boring.
No.
We have a fun topic today, disappointment. It sounds kind of depressing, but it's actually a fun topic, a good topic, and we're excited to be able to talk about it. So as we get started tonight for episode number 6, this is week 6 of... what are we calling this show?
Life with the Joneses.
Live with the Joneses, I guess.
How do you not know that?
Well, I didn't know if it was...
I think it's a coffee.
The Jones Life Live, or Live with the Joneses, or Keeping Up with the Joneses. What do you guys think? What should we name the show?
I don't like Keeping Up with the Joneses because it's very overused. Okay. Yeah.
Hi, so, Marta.
Hola, Marta. Saludos a los de Guadalajara. No, creo que estás en
Texas.
No, es la esposa de mi tío.
¿Cuál tío?
Gosh, Juan.
Tienes como 20.
Marta, ¿en dónde están viviendo ahorita? Se me fue el nombre.
All right, so anyhow, we are going to
hello, everyone.
Yes, thank you for joining us. Thank you for being here today. We're going to go ahead and get started. Tonight, we're going to be talking about dealing with disappointment. That's the topic of our show today. So,
Before we go further, we are live at the Jones page here. So if you see us looking around both sides, it's because we are live on this side. So we encourage you for next... my hairs are coming out. We encourage you for our next video to like our page, the Jones Live on Facebook. We do have a website. We're on YouTube as well. Stay on this one because we seem that people are
what
always
is this
on.
Because these people
mine,
know what this one
my
means.
Personal one.
If
my
you're
personal.
On, if you're looking at Joanna's, then yeah.
Yes. So please jump on over if you wish. We are live at the Jones Life as well too. So yeah. So sorry, you were saying.
Well, now I'm gonna share it on mine just to make sure.
Ricky's friends.
All right. So today, as I was saying, our topic is dealing with disappointment. We're going to be talking about disappointment today. We're going to share some of our own personal experiences, ways that we face disappointment, and we're also going to share some ideas for overcoming disappointment. How do we get past it? And we're going to review a powerful movie that we watched this week, a movie that touches on the same topic of disappointment, but it's in a very powerful way. And we're also going to look at an example of disappointment from the life of Jesus himself. So that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. And Joanna has a question.
What? So before we go further, hi, Sister Maria. We're going to ask you guys a question so you guys could kind of get involved. We have lots of viewers viewing us right now. So that's the whole point, that we're here to be with you guys and share. So it's a conversation. You know, just lay back. We're here at our house. Just
lay back.
Look, with my cool shirt. The party, what is it?
The Nas. It says the party don't start till I walk in, and it has Woody from The Jones Life.
Anyhow,
or from Toy Story.
The Jones Life.
Okay. This is The Jones Life. This is Toy Story.
Sorry. Anyhow, so we always like to start with the questions so we could kind of get ideas with the conversation.
So feedback from you guys.
Feedback from you guys, exactly. So don't be afraid. Please share on the comments below and let us know what you guys think. So the question we're going to start is, which one was it? We had a couple of them and we had to like go with one.
Yeah. So I think the question that we decided was, in what aspect of your life do you most often face disappointment? So that could be your marriage, could be your, you know, in school, it could be with your kids.
Or maybe nothing.
Or maybe I think we all face disappointment in some way, though.
Maybe somebody that's super happy.
So we want to know, leave a comment, in what aspect of your life do you most often face disappointment? You don't have to be super specific about what the disappointment is, but, you know, is it marriage? Is it family life? Is it in the home? Is it at school? Is it at work? In what aspect of your life do you most often face disappointment? Let us know in the comments below.
How about you?
Are we being real? No, I'm just kidding. In what aspect of life do we most often face disappointment?
That's a hard question to think about. Like, we thought about it for you guys, and now that I think about it, that's hard.
Put me on the spot. No, but I think it's good, like, for example, in my faith, because I fail so often. Finances, definitely, because I disappoint myself very often.
Dumb decisions? I'm just kidding.
Exactly. And I think we talked about that last week, right? Finances. Mm-hmm. What about you? Disappointment.
That's a hard question. Honestly,
maybe think about it. Like, in what aspect of your life are you not the person that you wish you were? Like, are you the mother that you wish you were? Are you the wife that you wish you were? Maybe if you think of it that way.
What are you trying to say?
I'm giving you examples of what what you could say.
Did you say hi to Juan? Hi, Brittany. Hi, Juan. Thank you for watching. This is an hour long video, so we'll be here for a long time, so you better comment.
Just getting started. The action is just about to begin.
I don't know. That's a hard question. Oh my goodness. Let me think.
So we want to hear from you guys. In what aspect of your life do you most often face disappointment? Let us know in the comments below. Janice is thinking. She says,
That's a hard one.
You still haven't come up with yours?
Mm-mm.
I would say my faith and my finances is where I think I struggle the most with disappointment, because you set certain goals, you have certain expectations, and then you fall short. So I think that's where I feel that I most often face disappointment.
I would say, my cousin was here and she was watching Bad Mom or something like that.
She picked it, or you picked it?
She picked it. Oh, but you know, there's some good parts at the end. I really like the end because the women, you know, it shows that you have to be there for your kids. So I would say for myself, I would, you know, being a good mom, sometimes, like, you think that you're a bad mom, you know, but there's no such thing as, I mean, you try your best. My mom always says, we're not born with a book underneath our arm and learning, you know, with all the instructions of how to be a parent. So you learn in the process. So sometimes, you know, you get that guilt of, am I doing the right thing? You know, today I thought about it, watching that movie, you know, what's going to happen when our kids grow up? They're going to continue the faith that we're teaching them, you know, and so forth. So that came to my head, and it's like, because of watching that movie, and even though they cuss a lot, you know, there's a lot of bad scenes, but the end, you know, it shows that the moms had to just say, you know, I'm a good mom, you know, and I think sometimes just letting go of that and saying, you know, you're going to do what you can. You're going to try your best.
Right.
Be the best that you can.
Janice says, in myself, in my faith, I need to stay on track. So that's where I'm at too, Janice.
Yeah.
Hello, David.
Hi, David. So we started with the question, what in what areas of your life do you find that you...
So you most often face disappointment.
It's a hard question. So it took us what?
Maybe you disappoint yourself. Maybe somebody else disappoints you.
Or somebody.
Yeah.
That one's hard. Yes, buddy.
In that case, we don't want you to say their name. You don't have to put them on blast or anything. But so before
your
we move
husband,
on.
Your wife. I'm just kidding.
Oh, no, we did that already. So what is the definition of disappointment? So the definition of disappointment is the feeling of sadness or displeasure caused by the non-fulfillment of one's hopes or expectations. The feeling of sadness or displeasure caused by the non-fulfillment of one's hopes or expectations. So that's what disappointment is all about. It's like, you know, we set expectations for ourselves. We have, you know, what we expect, what we hope for. And when we fall short of that, we feel down. We feel disappointed. We feel discouraged. You know, we'll talk about that today. So that's the dictionary definition of disappointment. The way
pretty
I would say it is
self-explanatory.
Falling short of your expectations.
Yep.
So we wanted to, like we said, we're going to share a couple examples of our own personal experiences with disappointment, how we got past it, how we dealt with that, and then we'll get into also a movie recommendation that we want to make that's related to this topic that was really powerful for both of us. And then at the end, we'll talk about Jesus and the great disappointment that he faced as well. So,
well, I think now that you say that, you know, when we choose this topic for to do the live video, we don't choose it till like today. So we don't really you know, talk about it and stuff. We just kind of, you know, randomly. But
well,
not,
sometimes we have like an idea,
right,
but we're not sure.
Right. But now thinking about it, it seems that, again, we're always laughing. You know, we are being prepared. Like throughout the whole week, and we actually go through it, and then we talk about it. So it's like, it's amazing, you know. And we're like,
well,
why,
that's
you
something
know?
That I've learned, like throughout this past year, is that when I'm gonna talk about something, when I'm gonna preach about something, God will force me to
go through it
to live it out before I can go tell somebody else.
Right.
And that's what it says in the Bible, right? You gotta practice what you preach. And I think God, speaking of, here
Joshua.
Is our beloved son Joshua.
They're
he
watching
wants you
a movie.
To see up his nose.
Be careful. Be nice.
Say hi to the people.
You're hungry? There's popcorn.
Where's
I made
popcorn?
Popcorn. I made him some popcorn. They're watching a movie.
Say hi. Welcome to the Jones Life.
He's just there.
No?
Okay.
Are you going to say hi or no? You have to, if you're going to be on there, you have to say hi to the people. They want you to say hello.
Okay.
Say hi, people.
He calls them humans. He's like, Mommy, I don't like humans.
Say hi, humans. Say it.
There's some aliens, I guess, out there. Anyways, going back to the subject, I think it's amazing, you know, that we actually go through these experiences. And this is one experience that we're going to share with you guys that actually happened this past
weekend.
Sunday. So it's very fresh to us. And like I mentioned, you know, we kind of sit down and we're like, okay, what are we going to talk about? And it seemed like that subject came up, you know, subject came. And so it worked out perfectly. So today we're going to be talking about disappointment and how often, you know, does it happen daily in our lives, you know, every once in a while, and maybe not, you know, none or very rare. So if it's very rare, you're a blessed person and you're a very happy person. Anyhow, so this Sunday we had, Joshua, can you sit over here? Daddy's going to... this Sunday we had, as most of you know, we have a nonprofit called the Rock Association, and we raise funds for a priest. We raise funds to build buildings in Africa. That's our mission right now. So at this point, we're doing a convent in Tanzania, Africa, and it's in the process of being built, and we're on stage 3, which is building the roof. So we've been like going crazy trying to like find different ways of how to, you know, fundraise this money. So we have our little core team. We get together, we talk about, you know, what we need to do throughout, you know, 6-month period and different events and so forth. So we decided to do a flea market and get all these vintage items. And you heard us talk about it. You know, if you had any donations or come on over to the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, which is a huge place. It's a big, 40,000 people go to this event. So it's a huge event. So that was one of our, you know, ideas. So
fundraiser.
So we thought, you know, the things that were donated to us, we thought it was just going to be easy stuff, you know, like clothing and furniture and so forth. But it took us like at least three weeks to like put together all this stuff, you know, that we have donated.
Yeah, I think initially it was like more like a yard sale kind of thing. You grab what you have, you put it up for sale. But it turned into a full-time job for like 3 weeks for this one and her
my other comadre. Which for me, I loved it, but it was, and I'm pretty sure she did it with her, you know, she loves it. She loves doing all that stuff.
Right,
but we didn't want to, you know, put trash out there. Like, we fixed the things and we made it look nice and, you know, make it worth something. And so, but we didn't think it was going to be that much work. Anyhow, it was very draining. It was very, a lot of hard work. I told Ricky I would get home like from 8 a.m. till like 7 or 9. I'm like, oh man, this is like, I'm tired, you know? But through the process, I was just thankful, you know, that I was able to be part of something like that, you know? So we get there on Sunday at 3 a.m. We only slept 2 hours. We only slept 2 hours that day, Sunday morning. But, you know, we had energy. Like, we're, like, super pumped and we're excited, you know, to be there, to set up at 3 a.m. From, like, 4 to, like, 7, we were there to, you know, setting up.
It was a Sunday, so you guys had to go to Mass on Saturday night.
So it was super draining. But still, I'm that type of person that I get excited about everything, you know? So we made this like cool, awesome like setup, you know? It looked like IKEA. You could go in there and like shop furniture and stuff.
Like the other regulars were telling you guys.
Wow, a lot of people would come up to us and they would be amazed by the way we set it up. And this is a flea market. People don't care how it looks. Like, we were in the vintage area, so we try to make it more, you know, nice. And because that's my friend and my personality, you know, I'm an event planner, so I like to make things pretty. Anyhow, so we set up and we're there waiting. Our first sale, this guy comes up and tells us, I'll give you this much for these chairs. They're vintage chairs, refurbished, a lot of work went in on them. So I guess these chairs are probably worth like $300, and he taught me down to like $100 for one of them and $60 for the other one. And he told me that he wanted that price because he wanted to fix it and sell it. So we sold it. So that was our first sale. But
they were all excited about it.
But deep inside, we felt like we just got ripped off, you know? I'm like, okay, it's okay, you know? So then Ricky goes to the other side of the area, like I mentioned, this place is huge. Like, it's,
I was still unloading stuff from the car and bringing it back.
He comes up to us and he's like, Joanna, the guy's selling your chairs over there. And I'm like, what? I was like, oh my gosh. Like, he told us he sells stuff and that he was going to fix it. But I didn't know he was like here, you know? So I guess he just
as is. He bought them from her and went and put them on his spot and put them up.
And like, his stuff was like $400 to $600. So this guy was going to market like 3 to 4 times, you know, more than we sold it. So I was heartbroken. I was like,
you were disappointed.
I was disappointed. Like, honestly, I was like, oh my gosh. I'm like, I don't even want to walk over there because I'm kind of like, I don't know what I that feeling was still in there. No, but I told him like, this money is not for us. You know, like, this money is for a fundraiser. Like, this is going towards a good cause. And he was still like, okay, I'll give you $100, you know? And I was like, okay, that's fine, because that's just my type of personality, and I wanted to just get rid of this stuff, but at a good price too, you know?
But in that case, you know, you did what you said what you had to say. It's on him.
No, yeah, and you know, it took a couple of hours, like, for me to get over it, and even my comadre, you know, she was like, I bet you he's going to sell it for, like, $300, and I was like, oh my gosh, he probably is, you know? But, you know, I don't know if you said it or something, it's like, you did what you had to do, you know, and it's up to him. You don't know if,
Jenna says, that's why I won't have a garage sale, because I won't haggle. Yeah, I'm not good at it either. That's why I wasn't there. I went and I was babysitting.
I was there by myself, and I'm like, they're like, you do it, you know, and I'm good at that stuff, but, like, this guy was our first sale, you know, but he took advantage of us. Definitely he took advantage of us, but, you know, I was like, it's okay. You know, it's not, I'll leave it to God, and nothing Ricky said, it just, you know, you did what you had to do, and I was like, okay, you know, that's true. So I think I didn't let go of it until, like, the next day, you know, like I still had that little disappointment, you know, but I was like, okay. And throughout the day, you know, we weren't getting any sales. So I'm like, what's going on?
So what happened is they had gone to mass the day before, but I didn't because I was planning to stay home with the boys while they were doing the sale because we didn't want to have them there all day. And so I left after we set up in the morning. I go pick up the boys. We go to mass. This was Palm Sunday. Mm-hmm. So take the boys to mass for Palm Sunday. And then I actually took them to the zoo just to kind of let them get out because we had been so busy and they had been driving around all week. So I wanted them to have fun. We went to the zoo. And so every like hour I would call Joanna. I'm like, hey, babe.
He's like, what's the progress?
Yeah, give me a progress update.
I was like, nothing.
She was like, we haven't sold anything. I was like, are you serious? And like you said, at first it's like that feeling of disappointment because we had all put work into this, especially them. You know, it was like a full-time job almost, refurbishing all this furniture. But after putting in all that work and then going there and not getting the sales that we expected, because we expected, okay, we're going to sell everything, you know, or at least a large part of what we're putting together. But that wasn't the case. So
anyway, to make the story short, because I know time flies, we made $500 worth of sales, which is okay, but compared to what
we were expecting a couple thousand.
$1,000.
If we would have sold everything, it would have been a couple $1,000.
Definitely, because I mean, these were beautiful pieces, you know, that were donated, and everything was awesome, you know? And so,
everything is awesome.
But there was just different things. Like, I guess the part that we were, like, in the vintage area, like, that's the end of the place. So I guess we had to be more in the middle. And
it's
little
not
things,
a high traffic area. It's, right. Like, kind of off to the side.
So we learned a lot of, like, little things here and there, you know? So in my point, I would do it again, but just in the right place. And then...
We'll have to take a vote on that one.
No, hold on. By the half of the thing, you know, because we had another friend come over. Her name is Sandra. Thank you so much, Sandra. You did an awesome, awesome job with your daughter.
Hold on, before you say that, though. Because
I'm not done.
I know, but you're going to get into a different... I wanted to mention one thing before you talk about that.
Okay.
So, the funny thing was that, like, once... Like, we had to rent a whole U-Haul to haul all this stuff, right? Because we brought it from Simi Valley all the way to the Rose Bowl. And so we unpacked everything, set it all up. And then, you know, you said we sold like $500 worth of stuff, which sounds decent. But that was three chairs and a couple of little items here and there. Mm-hmm. So at the end of the day, we had to basically load everything back up into the U-Haul again. And we get to Daisy's house where we took all the stuff from. And her husband opens the truck and is like, wait, there's a problem here. This truck is supposed to be empty. So,
well, anyhow, before that, so, you know, halfway of this event... We just kind of, you know, because people would come up to we had a booth table at the front, which we have shirts and you know, business cards.
Our swag.
No.
The rock swag.
To show people what, we were the only nonprofit there, you know? So we were the only religious cause, I guess you would say, you know, nonprofit. And so people would come up to us and just, you know, be interested. So, you know, halfway I'm like, you know what? I think our purpose was there to evangelize, you know, and to show people that you could help people out there, you know, you could do something nice for other people, you know?
To share our cause.
And so we had a lot, like I mentioned, people would come in inside our little, you know, what do you call it, setup, and they would just, like, take a breather, and they were like, oh my gosh, this is so nice. Not to, like, you know, say, oh, it was good, but they would actually feel like they were at peace in there, and were like, you know what? Even though we didn't have the sales that we needed, we were evangelizing, you know, everyone that would come up to our table and stuff, you know, and so we gave a lot of business cards out because people wanted it to know more about it. And at the end, we had a couple, you know, that bought an $80, chair. And they were just very impressed with what we do and what our nonprofit is. And so at the end of the event, we just kind of, you know, I wasn't disappointed. I was disappointed at what the guy did, you know, but the whole event, it was a learning experience, and I was thankful that we were there, and me and my friend, you know, my comadre said, I would definitely do this again, you know, and we spread the word, you know, that's what we do. We were spreading the word to do good out there, you know, and people were asking, why Africa, why Tanzania? And I mentioned, you know, Africa in general has been in my heart since I was very young. For some reason, Africa would always come to my head, and that's why we started in Africa. But I told this guy, we're not only gonna, you know, stay in Africa. The whole point of doing this is to go, you know, all over the world. And so they were very impressed. And I know that there's other nonprofits out there that do good, and you know, we have to be out there, you know. And yeah, it was stressful. It was a lot of work. But at the end, you know, we were at peace. We were thankful, you know, that we got to meet a lot of people and we were spreading, you know, the word basically, you know. So at the end, I was happy. I was, you know, content. It was tiring, you know, like anything. I felt it was like a retreat, you know, for us. But I was, you know, I was okay. I was okay. Okay. Later, we posted this stuff to this website called OfferUp, and we've been getting a lot of sales there, you know. So, you know, there was good outcome from that, you know. So even though we didn't expect what we wanted at this event, like I said, this is a recent experience that we had, so we wanted to talk about it, you know, because it makes sense for this. Even though we didn't, you know, it was a successful, you know, event, fundraising wise, you know. We reach souls. That's always in my mind, you know. We're reaching out to these people. And, you know, we maybe made a difference in someone, you know. And so
planted a seed in
exactly,
someone's life.
Exactly. And so I was happy. I was thankful. So that was our little story from this week, which was a lot. But, yeah.
So we're talking about dealing with disappointment. If you're just joining us or if you missed the beginning of the show, our topic today is dealing with disappointment. And so we just shared, Joanna just shared an experience that we had this past weekend on how we faced disappointment by not reaching the sales that we wanted for the fundraiser that we did on Sunday, Palm Sunday.
Do you guys think that it's different, there's a difference between women and men? Like,
as far as what?
Disappointment? Like the way you take it?
I think it depends what it is.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I guess.
Why?
No, like you took it like more like, oh, you know, why didn't...
Well, and I think
Do you think it's a man thing or it's just your personality? No. Well, because you don't have that type of personality, though, that's all. So I guess it depends on the circumstance, you know, and the...
Well, yeah, and I think it was more... Part of it was I wasn't there. You guys were there, and I hadn't... That was before you had explained to me that whole idea of, you know, even though we didn't reach our sales, you know, the plans changed. Not the plans changed,
but... Men don't talk about it. They just give you the look.
That's true. Accepting failure in a sense. That's a big thing. True. Especially for guys to say, you know, what we failed, that's serious. But in this case, like right away I felt like, man, we failed. As soon as I got there, that she said that we didn't make any sales pretty much.
We made $500, right, but it was right. For cost, you know.
But I'm saying our expectation was here, our sales were about there. So when I saw that I was like, that's a failure, right? When you think of it just numbers-wise, worldly-wise. So I think in that sense, for me, it was like, okay, this was a failure. And she was like, oh, we should do it again. I was like, to me, it's like, why would you want to do that again? You know, in a sense, we almost lost money. So it was, to me, a disappointment. But that was before we had the conversation about how God, you know, had other plans. And you guys were able to, a lot of people were interested in learning more about the cause. So, you know, it was promotion as well. Not just fundraising. So I think that's why my initial reaction, yes, it was disappointment. And that's why I wanted to bring it up this week, because of that. I felt disappointed when you told me that. But now, which is what we're going to talk about, is ideas for overcoming disappointment. After you shared that point of view, I was able to overcome those feelings of disappointment that I had about our expectations not being met and accept the fact that God had other expectations for this event.
And I think, you know, that's when different personalities come into place. My personality is more outgoing, more, you know, I accept things, you know, on whatever way they come. And then my comadre, you know, she's very mellow, very spiritual. And Ricky's very, you know, mellow as well, too. So it balances out, you know, so it definitely helps a lot when you have different minds.
Right.
Even though you say that sometimes the more...
Perspectives,
you know,
I think.
Exactly, yeah. Because it's true, you know. Sometimes, like, you're so set on one thing and you don't get to see other things, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so, I think that's the wonderful thing about community and working together, you know, with other people. And don't be afraid. So, we were so blessed, like I mentioned, that Sandra was there. She's very outgoing, very positive, you know. So, she was there for a reason. And then my comadre, too. And she mentioned, you know, I'm learning a lot from you guys because she's very mellow. And so, I think for me, every experience and everything that we do, it's a learning experience, you know. And so, I'm always thankful for it.
And I think when we're going to talk about ideas for overcoming disappointment, that is one of them, right? So, having support, having a circle of support, forming that group of people that you can have around you that will help you Maybe maybe you have different perspectives. Maybe you're not on the same page on everything, but that's a good thing because you're able to benefit from the perspective that other people have.
Exactly.
And that's exactly what Joanna is sharing. So that's one of the ways I think that we can overcome disappointment. When you try to stay to yourself, and like you said, you kind of put those blinders on. So you got tunnel vision and you can only see the what negative. You want to see. When you have other people in the picture, they can help you to broaden the horizon and see, you know, the different ways of looking at that same disappointment to be able to overcome it. So that right. I think that's one of the ideas of overcoming disappointment.
And just being open to other positive ideas, you know. So
right.
Definitely. So that definitely worked out, you know. So that's talking back to our disappointment this weekend.
All right. Hi, Grace. Hi, Bianca, my little sister. Happy birthday
to you.
So let's see. What are some other ideas for overcoming disappointment? I think disappointment can also lead to discouragement. So if you stay stuck in your disappointment, like I said, we were just talking about that. You know, if we have those blinders on for, you know, if we were staying in that moment, if we're staying in that feeling of disappointment and we dwell on it, that just leads to discouragement. And discouragement means we're going to be less likely to want to do it again in the future. So, like with the example that we just shared with this fundraising event, the disappointment sets in, and then you allow that to develop by dwelling on that disappointment, saying, oh, this was horrible, this was horrible, this was horrible. Then you become discouraged, and you don't want to do it again. Whereas Joanna didn't feel that. She was like, let's do it again tomorrow.
I loved it.
Why would you want to do this?
So many awesome things to shop for.
Right. So, well, shopping is different than selling. But yeah, I think that idea of like where I was coming from was, I was still stuck in that moment, in that initial disappointment that I was feeling. So allowing yourself to dwell on that leads to discouragement, which is going to affect the future of things that you might want to do too. So that shows how disappointment can be a very powerful thing in a negative way to prevent you from being able to excel past or to overcome that. So
yep,
I think that's another example. Let's see, you wanted to talk about that?
Oh, yeah. I love listening to Patrick Madrid in the morning.
Immaculate
I think
Heart
Immaculate Heart Radio from 6 a.m. to 9 a.m., I believe. 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah, I think it's 3 hours. So Immaculate Heart Radio, if you haven't heard of a really nice faith, you know, based show, please listen to Immaculate Heart Radio. It's Catholic based, so you get to learn more about the Catholic Church and our, again, you know, experiences from other people. So Patrick Madrid is a theologian. What is
he? You can call him a theologian.
Theologian. So he knows a lot about the church. Anyhow, he's always talking about the Beatles. I think he loves the Beatles. And the Beatles, you know, it's the greatest example of, you know, people not giving up. Like Ricky mentioned, if, you know, with this experience, even though we didn't do good, if I was very, like, stuck on, you know, being disappointed of what happened, and it's not going to allow me to, you know, to do it again. So I block myself. You put a blockage in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of just have to, you know, let go and do it again. That's
right.
What the Beatles did, you know?
Right.
How many times did they get denied, you know, and all these record labels? Millions of them. Not millions. I like to get very, use like...
Exaggerate.
Hyperbole. Ricky's like, millions? Probably, you know, more than 5 times. I don't know the number, buddy. Go back, please. They're eating popcorn. But did they give up? No, they didn't. They kept going and going, and finally, you know, a record label said, you know, let's give them a chance and see what's going to happen with these guys, you know, and so they did. So if we get stuck in that, the same thing with singers, you know, and actors, they probably get denied many times, you know. I remember when I went to college, I was going through some stuff and some letters, and I was like, you know what, if it's meant to be, it's meant to be. And I kept going and kept going to admissions and records, you know, and finally I got accepted and I went to college. And so I kept trying and we kept trying. And so, you know, you have to remember that we can't give up. And the same thing with disappointment, you know, we cannot let disappointment let us get stuck in that place. And we have to try it again. And I'm pretty sure, you know, you'll learn a lot of things from trying and trying and trying. So, you know, I wanted to bring up the Beatles the Beatles story of how they never gave up, you know, and so always remember that.
Perseverance,
yeah.
Other thing I wanted to say was the idea of gratitude. I think gratitude and being thankful kind of changes the way you you perceive things. So when you're grateful for where you're at, for what God has done for you, I think you're less likely to want to complain. You're less likely to want to dwell on the disappointments, because you'll be able to appreciate what you've been given. There's a quote I wanted to share. It's by Kristen Armstrong. It says, when we focus on our gratitude, the tide of disappointment goes out and the tide of love rushes in. I think that was a powerful quote from Kristen Armstrong. Basically, the idea that when we're grateful, that disappointment that we're feeling inside gets washed away by the love that God is pouring out into our lives. The feelings of gratitude push away those feelings of disappointment. So I think that's another way to overcome those feelings of disappointment. And the last one, I think, is to learn to see things God's way. We think, especially when it comes to setting expectations, right? We want to think that the way we want it is the right way, or the way that we want it is the best way, the way that's best for us. But I think a lot of times, it's not. God's way is what's best for us. And what we want is not always what God wants. And so I think learning to accept, not just to accept what God wants, but to want what God wants, to want what God wants, is a better way. And there's a couple of quotes I wanted to share also. From Isaiah 55, it says,
look what I opened to.
All right, we'll share that right now. Let me just share these quotes real quick. So from the book of Isaiah, it says, my thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. So God's plan for us, God's desires for us, sometimes we don't understand them. Sometimes they're just over our head, and we get stuck on what we want and what our expectations are. So learning to see things from God's perspective also, just like we talked about having other people around us, a circle of support. God can be a part of that circle of support, because we can start to see things from His way, mm-hmm. and that changes everything. And the other quote was from the book of Jeremiah. It says, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. So to understand that that's what God is trying to tell you. You know, God has a plan for you, and it might go against what you have planned for yourself. His expectations for you are even higher than your own. He's got different expectations. So to learn to understand, or to desire to meet God's expectations and not necessarily your own, I think that changes the way you overcome those feelings of disappointment as well. Yes. And then Joanna has just found one right here too.
I love Mother Teresa. Saint Mother Teresa. One, because, you know, I'm pretty sure all of you have heard of Mother Teresa. So that says a lot, you know, that says a lot from one person that, you know, this tiny little person, I think she was like 4'11", I don't know, something, you know, very small. I'm 5 feet.
With socks on, she's 5 feet.
No, I'm 5 feet.
Keep that barefoot, record. She's 4'11" and 3/4.
I'm 5 feet.
Okay.
But anyhow, and, you know, how just from little things that she would do, you know, how much she impacted, you know, the world. And so I love her quotes. I love her story. And I definitely recommend you, if you're having, you know, any spiritual, you know, trouble, challenges, look into her, you know, read her books. This is one. It's called Love. Super simple. It has quotes. You know, just wake up and read them, and they encourage you and they challenge you to be a better person, to love others, you know, and to be humble and so many things, you know. So I just opened this and look what, I didn't open it. I did like three pages and I found this. They're going to be like, oh, she's a witch. It says, do not allow yourself to be disheartened by any failure as long as you have done your best. So again, you know, we do our best, we try, but sometimes things don't come up, and that's life. That's life in general. You know, you plan things, and I'm an event planner, you know, I always plan in my head, and then on writing or a computer. Does it have pictures? Yes, it does have pictures, Carmen.
It has
a couple of pictures of her, like, holding kids.
Yeah, like, the first part is, like,
but
kind of
super simple. That was, like, a sentence right there, you know?
Like, each page is just, like, one quote, and it's got, like, little design
and
stuff.
So it's different
really
quotes.
Really cool
it's
book.
It's super awesome.
We got it for $1. Most of these books we get at the thrift store and stuff.
Yeah.
I actually gave one of these away when I did my workshop, when I released my book, so
It's a really nice book. Definitely.
Beautiful little book.
We'll put a link below. I lost my train of thought. Sorry.
And I lost the page. Okay.
What did I say?
Failure and all of that.
I forgot. Sorry. But, you know, again, trying our best. And, you know, we plan, you know, I'm an event planner and I plan things. And there has to be a foundation, of course, you know. Without a foundation, I think, you know.
It falls.
The building will fall, you know. Yeah. So it's important to have, you know, a foundation and plan things. But you just have to accept and be open to know that sometimes it's going to go your way or sometimes it's not going to go. And that's just life, you know, and there's going to be disappointment. No matter what, disappointment's always going to be there. But we need to work on ourselves first to accept, you know, to be open to accept whatever's going to come from that. So definitely recommend that. It's called Love, and it's by Mother Teresa. Super simple. And this is another one. We found it at the thrift store, probably. It's called Believe. Desmond Tutu. Is he a bishop?
He's an Anglican bishop from Africa. Mm.
So the same thing. He has quotes. They're quotes from him. They're all usually
just
quotes.
About faith, I think.
So definitely look into those books. They're called Blue Mountain Art, and they're awesome because they're like really soft and like little and cute. But anyhow,
that's a good reason to buy a book because they're soft and little and cute.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You just said something that we're all gonna face disappointment no matter what.
Yeah.
And there was a quote that I wanted to share. This one's from Michael J. Fox. When I think of Michael J. Fox, I think of Back to the Future. But anyways, there's always failure, and there's always disappointment, and there's always loss. But the secret is learning from the loss and realizing that none of those holes are vacuums. I think it's important, you know. It's true, because no matter what, we're going to face disappointment, we're going to face failure, and we're going to face loss. But those things don't have to prevent us from moving on, right? Mm-hmm. And we're going to talk about that in the next segment, unless you had anything else to add.
Nope. If you guys have any comments or questions, please, before we move forward to the last thing.
Yeah, what do you guys think are good ways to overcome disappointment? Let us know in the comments below what pointers or ideas or tips or strategies do you have that you can share with us and everybody about how to overcome disappointment. What do you guys do when you're feeling disappointed?
Do you reach out to somebody, or do you eat cakes or cupcakes?
Joanna eats cake. That's why she's eating cake right now in the video.
No. I have some leftovers from yesterday. I did a tres leches cake, so I had to do it and eat it. Somebody has to eat it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm eating it. Come on, people. Comment.
Let us know. How do you guys overcome disappointment?
Or something that we didn't mention. Or what do you guys think so far of the things that we mentioned, you know,
Which is your favorite of those ideas that we shared?
You guys can, and we'll repeat them. Go ahead.
We talked about gratitude and being thankful and how that changes the way that you see disappointment. We talked about accepting failure, that it's not a bad thing sometimes. It actually teaches us lessons that we need to learn. Not dwelling on the disappointment, because that leads to discouragement. Mm-hmm. We talked about forming a strong circle of support, which includes friends, family, and God. Accepting imperfection. That was one I think that we missed too. So if it's something that involves another person, you know, or even yourself, sometimes you hold yourself at a really high standard. You have high expectations for yourself. And when you fail, you're striving for perfection. And it's hard for you to accept the fact that you're not perfect. Or maybe it's your spouse. Maybe I expect her to be perfect, and when she's not, I feel disappointed. So I think being able to accept imperfection, because no one's perfect. Not you and not anyone else in your life.
From everyone. Exactly. That's a good one. We say that a lot, like in, you know, retreats and self-acceptance, you know. Until you don't accept yourself and love yourself the way you are, mm-hmm. and understand that, you know, God loves you, I think it's harder to accept other things, you know. And so I think that's a very, very important one. Definitely. So I think people are just shy and don't want to comment.
Don't be shy, guys. So we're going to go ahead and move on.
We're going to move on to the next.
We only got about 20 minutes left. We got two more segments we want to get to. So the next one we have mentioned before that we watched a very powerful, moving film this weekend. Well, this week. Mm-hmm. And it's called Collateral Beauty. So if you haven't seen it, it's a very powerful movie. It's got Will Smith, Kate Winslet, Edward Norton. Those are the only ones that I know their names.
I'm like, okay, there's, you know them all.
The poster has all the names, but those are the ones that I know.
Collateral Beauty.
Yeah.
If you guys have watched it, comment below, yes or no. It's a must watch. Again, you know, I run into it on this app that I have, and me and my cousin were like watching movies all week, and we're like, oh, let's watch it, you know. Did I watch it with her? Yeah, I did.
I had seen the title and I had like heard it, and I was like, it doesn't sound like, oh, I want to watch this. But they told me, oh, Ricky, you have to watch it. It was amazing. And so
we watched it.
Well, and then you guys watched that, and then you watched 7 Pounds, which is also with Will Smith, which is a pretty powerful movie as well. Mm-hmm. So when I got back from work, they were like in the tail end of 7 Pounds, which if you haven't seen that one, watch that one too. And so they said it was as powerful as that one. So I was like, okay, if it's that good, then I'll watch it. So I watched it, and it was good.
So Collateral Beauty. So we'll finish off with this.
Actually, we still have two more things to talk about.
Okay, go ahead.
Uh-oh, he has to go.
Okay, go.
Elijah's potty training, which is still a work in progress. So I wanted to give you a little, just a quick summary of what the movie's about. Buddy, that's gross. This is not for your nose. So spoiler alert. Please don't put it in your nose, buddy, because you're going to get boogers on it. So, the spoiler alert, because I'm going to probably mention some stuff about the ending, so I don't want to... If you haven't seen the movie and you're going to see it, plug your ears. Anyway, so it's Will Smith. He works for this advertising agency, and the first scene, he's like, everything is good, everything is awesome. And so, like 5 minutes later, it shows him a year or a couple years later, and he looks old, he looks tired, he looks not happy. And so we learned that his daughter, who was like 6 years old in the movie?
Yeah, six.
6 years old, had died from some rare form of cancer or something. And so he was really, I guess, disappointed. He was going through a very, very difficult period of loss in his life. And so that affected everything in his life. It affected his marriage, it affected his work, and so the movie basically is his co-workers and friends trying to help him to get past that, trying to help him to overcome the disappointment that he was feeling. And it's an interesting way they go about it. I won't get into it because it's pretty cool how, if you just sit down and watch it, it's a very creative way to talk about this idea. And so basically he's going through this dark time in his life, and instead of dealing with it, instead of attempting to overcome it, what he's actually doing is he's dwelling on the disappointment. He's dwelling on the fact that he's lost his daughter. It's been, I think at the time we see in the movie, it's been two years since she's passed away. And he's dwelling on this moment. And instead of trying to overcome it, he's just staying stuck in that moment. And we kind of learn as the movie goes on is that's kind of the way he's trying to stay connected to her. So instead of letting go, instead of accepting the fact that she's gone, he's dwelling on the fact that he lost her, and he's mad and he's angry, and it's just, it's really transformed him into a bad person. And so over the course of the movie, he finally gets to the point where he can accept the fact that she's gone, that, you know, there's nothing he could do about it. He shouldn't be happy about it. But to accept it, to say, you know what, she's gone, there's nothing I can do to change that. I've got to accept it, and I've got to continue on living. And so, in the end, he does that. I won't explain how that all happens. I don't want to give too much away. But he's able to accept that, and then you see this transformation back. He gets his life back, and it's touching. It's beautiful, because he overcomes that disappointment. And obviously, the disappointment that he feels in this movie is nothing like what we're talking about in our examples. Ours is nothing compared to this. This is the most powerful way that you could probably lose a child. So, and they say, you know, like when someone's suffering, you don't tell them, oh, just embrace the suffering, or oh, just accept it, right?
Or, you know, when
and
somebody,
he even says that in
when
the movie.
Somebody
like,
passes
people
away,
try to say these things. And
when somebody passes away, say, you know, to never say, you know, I know what you're going through, because you don't know what that person is going through. So being sympathetic.
It's in God's plan or whatever, you know. And he addresses all those issues in the movie, which I think is important. I mean, if you're going through a situation like that, don't think that we're trying to play lightly on suffering. Suffering is very difficult.
Disappointment.
But we can't dwell in it. We can't stay in it, because God doesn't want that for you. You know, God is able to make good things happen through the suffering. And you'll see that in the movie. That's the title itself has to do with that, collateral beauty. And you'll see towards the end of the movie when they start to kind of describe what that whole idea is, collateral beauty. It's the same kind of sense of what we believe as Catholics is called the redemptive power of suffering. And Joanna's like, just shut off, because she hates when I use big words like that. So, but it means the same thing as collateral beauty, that good can come from suffering.
Exactly. And, you know, going back to that story, you know, support, you know, he got the support of friends that loved him. And so that, again, you know, it's an eye-opener for us, you know, when somebody's going through a rough time or suffering, you know, as Christians, as, you know, fellow brothers and sisters, we need to be there for those people, you know, and we need to sacrifice and challenge ourselves, you know, to be there for those that need us. And so,
well, and initially in the movie, the reasons that they're trying to help him are selfish reasons,
right?
But in the end, they realize the error of their ways. But I think it
worked out.
It was the support, yeah, definitely.
Exactly. So, you know, that was a very, you know, touching movie. And these are the ways, collateral beauty. So these are the ways that, you know, as humans, you know, we could feed ourselves, you know. We love movies. We love, you know, Ricky loves reading books.
Notice that she said, we love movies, but Ricky loves reading books.
You guys know that. You know I don't like reading books. I push myself. But, like, little books like this, I love because they're, like, super easy and cute, Ricky says. So we always have to remember to push ourselves to reach out to different resources out there, you know, that can make us grow, you know?
Like, whether you're in that situation or somebody you know and love is, to be there for them, to just be present to them, too.
So always, you know, being open again, you know, being open to new ideas, new things, and it, you learn from these things, you know? And so, we encourage you to watch The Collateral Beauty by Will Smith. It's not by him, but he's in it.
He's in it. Actor.
And it's awesome movie. So that's a more, what is it called? Impacted, you know, experience.
It's a beautiful movie, but it not only does it touch your heart, but it teaches, I think. And those are the kind of movies that I like. The movies that actually mean something. It's not just like mindless entertainment, but it actually, you walk away from it thinking, like, wow, you know, it impacted. Whereas, if it's just like an action movie, shoot 'em up, what do they call
them? What's that?
Like, where they're just killing people and stuff.
Oh, sure.
There's a name, but it escapes me at this moment.
So, Collateral Beauty, please, a must watch. Yeah.
All right, so
we'll finish off with this.
We have one more thing we want to talk about. And so, we're still talking about disappointment here. And today is Holy Thursday. So
what is Holy Thursday, Ricky?
Okay, here we go. So Holy Thursday is the Thursday before Easter. But I wanted to talk about it because I think there's a lot of disappointment in the very life of Jesus himself. And so just on this one day in his life, how much disappointment he faced. So I wanted to just kind of talk about that a little bit so that we can understand what we celebrate, what we should be kind of reflecting on today as we journey forth towards Easter, which is coming up in a couple days. So on this very night, on Thursday, almost 2,000 years ago, Jesus is celebrating the Last Supper with his disciples. And they have this meal, and everything is awesome. But then...
Everything is awesome.
That's kind of like a catchphrase around our house because of the Lego movie. But so Jesus has the Last Supper with his disciples, and he lets them know what's going to happen. So he knows what's going to happen, but I think there's still disappointment in him when it does happen. So it says that they sing songs and they go out to the Mount of Olives. So Jesus takes them out to basically what's like a grove of olive trees, which is called the Garden of Gethsemane. And so they go in there and Jesus says, I'm going to go forward to pray. I want you guys to stay right here, keep watch and pray. And so Jesus goes forward to pray. And it's, you know, one of the most difficult struggles of his life because he's trying to unite his will to the will of God. He says, God, you know, if there's any other way that you can make this happen without me having to suffer and die, let it be. But not my will, yours be done. And so this is that scene where it says that his sweat turned to drops of blood, because this is like the deep interior battle for him to unite his will to God's will. Because in doing so, it means that he's going to die. So to say, God, I want what you want, which is for me to die. That's, I mean, that's the ultimate
sacrifice.
Death to self, right? So that is where we're at in this scene, right? So he goes, he's doing that, he's talking to God. He comes back and he finds that the disciples have all fallen asleep. And he looks at them and says, you know, I'm in this moment of deep prayer. I come back and you guys can't even stay watch for an hour, right? And obviously they probably felt bad. And then he goes, he tells him again, okay, stay watch, pray, I'm going to go back. And so he does this three times. Each time he comes back, he finds them asleep. So obviously he's going through the most difficult time of his life, and his friends are falling asleep. That's disappointment number one. Disappointment number two is, after he's done this three times, he looks up, and here comes a crowd of people with torches and swords and weapons out to capture him, to arrest him. And they're led by one of his other friends, one of the men that he had chosen to be his disciples, Judas. And so Judas comes up to him and betrays him. He's the one who points out who Jesus is to the authorities, and he gets him arrested. So that betrayal of one of your closest friends, because these are the 12 guys that had lived with Jesus over the course of these past 3 years, intimate relationship with these guys. And one of those guys is the one who betrays him and turns him over to the people who will eventually kill him. That's a pretty deep disappointment for Jesus there. So that's disappointment number two. And then, at that moment, the rest of the disciples, the ones who, not including Judas, but the ones who are still there, they don't know what to do, so they all just take off running, and they run off in fear of their lives, because they don't want to get arrested, they don't want to get killed. So they all run away, and they're hiding in fear, while Jesus is going through this difficult moment in his passion. So that's disappointment number three, is that all his friends leave him. So now he's alone, and he's just been arrested, right? And of course, the ultimate one is he's hanging on the cross, and all of his friends still have abandoned him. There's a couple people there at the foot of the cross, his mother and a few of the women and the beloved disciple, but everybody else has abandoned him. And he's hanging there on the cross, and he says, my God, why have you abandoned me? So obviously, there had to be some feeling of disappointment in that sense, to know that all the people that he had loved, all those people, the large crowds of people that had followed him over the course of his time with them, had all abandoned him at this crucial moment in his life, when he's hanging on the cross dying for them, and they had all run away scared. So it's like, to see all these examples of disappointment in Jesus's life on this very day, I think is a powerful reflection on everything that we just talked about tonight. So I wanted to bring that up and leave that with you as you continue tonight in your reflections and your prayers for Holy Thursday. Tomorrow, of course, is Good Friday. And then on Sunday, we have Easter Sunday, the resurrection, when Jesus rises from the dead. So we hope that this kind of reflection, this conversation on the topic of disappointment and overcoming it has been helpful to you. We were hoping to get some feedback from you guys, but perhaps you guys will do that after the video.
You guys are tired.
Or maybe you're, yeah, so... But let us know in the comments if you have any ideas that we didn't share. You know, in what ways do you overcome disappointment? And I think Joanna wants to close with a quote.
Yeah. So thank you again for watching today, Thursday night. We love, you know, being here with you guys and sharing our faith, our experiences with you guys. You know, my mom's always laughing. You and your life thing, you know, and... We tell her, you know, it's not
to
show. And it's something that God put in our heart. And, you know, we need to speak up. We need to speak up, you know, and that's how you touch hearts out there. And so if we're doing it, it's possible for you to do the same thing. Just as we went out there, you know, in the Rose Bowl with thousands of people, even though we just, you know, we didn't do whatever we had to do, you know, ourselves, but we might touch somebody, you know, two people, two souls. So for us, that's a victory. And we won right there, right. You know. And so, there's a friend always telling us, like, oh, you guys are going to be millionaires. So I was like, you know, I don't want to be a millionaire. I don't want to have money. All I want is for people to see the joy and the love that we have so they could share it to the world, you know. Right now with all the wars and Syria and all that, it's sad, you know. It's sad. And, you know, this is why I love Mother Teresa, because she's always talking about, you know, wars. And the only way that you could fight wars is by love, you know, and just love. And for me, that's a big word, you know, love. You could build mountains or what do you say? I don't know. There's a thing, you know, I don't know what the love you could do something. Anyways, but
I have no idea.
But you know, definitely we encourage you to do the same thing. You know, and that's the whole point we're doing these videos to be here with you and to share our faith and our experiences. And like Ricky mentioned, you know, today's topic, disappointment. Our lives are not perfect. You know, there's always going to be disappointment, but we strive. We all strive for one goal, you know, to be happy, to be the best that we can.
Right.
And so,
before you read that, I just want to add one thing. So, to add to what she said about, you know, the disappointment that we felt at the sale that we had last weekend, but how we saw what God's plan was for in the end. I think the same thing happens with these videos. You know, like we've seen that the videos that we put out, we're not afraid to mention our faith, to talk about God. Obviously, that's not all we talk about, but we've seen the effect that that has, in the sense that, you know, we could get on here and like do dumb things and drink and say bad words or just talk about mindless stuff, and we'll probably get thousands and thousands of viewers. But when we talk about things of God, we don't get that same response, and that can be disappointing. That can be discouraging in a way. I've kind of gone through that already, so we've kind of learned that. But like Joanna said, we're not here to make $1 million. We're not here to be rich and famous. What we want is to plant as many seeds as we can. And so if we have one or two viewers, or if we have tens of thousands of viewers, we're still going to be here, as long as God is calling us to this. So we thank you guys for watching. And if you know someone in your life who might benefit from this topic, make sure to share this video with them.
Or
just
page.
Tag them in the comments below. And they'll see the video later on.
Yes. So thank you again. Have a blessed night. And we always love finishing with a quote. And today's quote is from Mother Teresa. It was unexpected. Like I mentioned, you know, everything that we do is we kind of, you know, go with the flow. And so this is the one that we chose. So next Thursday, we'll be here again.
8 p.m.
Yes, we'll
actually,
be here. Are we?
We have I think we have the wedding rehearsal next Thursday. Okay. So we will probably broadcast early next Thursday.
Or on our way over there. We're going to be at a wedding rehearsal. 7
yeah, that's
PM.
At 7.
So maybe we might do it.
We could do it at 9.
Yeah, we might change it
tonight.
We'll let you know. We'll put the app thing. Anyhow, so have a good night. We'll see you guys next Thursday, and I hope you have a blessed week. It says, I repeat that it is not what we do, but how much love we put into doing it.
That's from Mother Teresa.
And it says, exact from an address delivered in Rome, May 1982.
And then Veronica just also shared a quote that says, love is like a mountain. It's hard to climb, but the view is beautiful. With love, you can move mountains. I think that's the one that Joanna was looking for earlier. So thank you for sharing that,
Veronica. That's long. I wouldn't remember. I would have probably just remember love is like a mountain. Yeah, that's it. I think that's what I said. Thank you so much, Veronica. That's awesome. Thank you for finding it.
All right. And
thank
we'll
you, everyone.
Close with a little blessing. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May he let his face shine upon us and be gracious to us. May he look kindly upon us and grant us peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Say bye.
Say bye, Joshua.